Good morning. Welcome. We are gathered in this new way from our homes in San Rafael and Marin County, throughout California, New Mexico, Colorado, around the United States, England, and around the world. I'm Cynthia Cochran-Carney, the pastor of First Presbyterian Church in San Rafael. And we are gathered today as family members, friends, and colleagues to give thanks for the life of Lavinia McLean Fisher, whom most of us knew as Binnie. Wife, mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, aunt, friend. We come to celebrate her life and grieve her death and affirm our hope in God's eternal love and peace. We are doing this in a new way on Zoom, so I know for many of you this is a learning experience. So I hope that you have some help. If you need it, you may type in the chat room. On most computers, it's at the bottom. It says chat with a little bubble. Mike is our tech person, so if you want to type a message to Mike that you need some help, you can do that. But this will not be a time where you can unmute yourself and try to talk. That will be confusing. So we have muted everyone's mic, and the speakers will unmute themselves as it's time. There is a link to the bulletin, the order of service, in the chat room. So you can click on it and look at it or print it. And it's also on the church website, a link to the order of service, fpcsr.org. You don't need to have it, but if you would like it. The congregation of First Presbyterian Church indeed welcomes all of you. This was Binnie and Chuck's church for, I think, over 40 years, a congregation where she worshiped and sang and served as a leader and cared for others. I'm so glad that you are found your way here, and I know Binnie's family, extended family, is so grateful for all of her friends who have gathered together to support the family with your love. The journey of grief is made more bearable when we walk it together. I'd like to open now with a brief prayer. Holy and gracious God, who gives us life, you are ever present, filling us with love and light. Show us now your grace as we face the mystery of death. Bless this time as we remember Binnie and what she meant to each one gathered here. Comfort and guide her family and friends. Open us to your love through the music, words of scripture and poetry, stories shared, tears and laughter, and pictures of Binnie taken throughout her rich and long life. In our sadness and grief, may we know your peace. Amen. And now, Binnie's sister, Polly Bassett, we'll read Psalm 121. Holly, remember to unmute.
Psalm 121. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon my right hand. The sun shall not smite me by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy coming, going out, and thy coming in from this time forth, and even forevermore.
Thank you, Polly. One of Benny's favorite hymns was God of the Sparrow. You are invited to listen to this recording, to enjoy photos of birds taken by Chuck all over the world. The words of the hymn may be found on page 3 of the bulletin linked in the chat room and on the website. Our first scripture reading comes from the Gospel of Matthew. Both of them are. They're both about birds and the ways that Jesus used the image of birds to communicate his message of hope and good news. From Matthew chapter 6, verse 26, Jesus said as part of the Sermon on the Mount, look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap, nor gather in barns, and yet God feeds them. And from the end of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 23, verse 37, as Jesus was facing his trial and the end of his life, he was weeping over the city of Jerusalem and offered these words: "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings." Binny was certainly a lover of people and birds and nature and music. She loved in so many different ways. I wish I had known Binny longer. I arrived in April of 2019 to start serving as the pastor here at First Presbyterian Church in San Rafael. One of my early memories from those first months was going to Binny and Chuck's home for one of the supper club gatherings, a small gathering of people from the church, potluck dinner, time to be together. Clearly, they had the gift of hospitality. There was just leisurely talking and laughing and telling stories on their patio. And then everyone packed into the dining room, around the dining room table, for a wonderful meal and conversation. I was certainly moved by Binny's deep love for nature. One thing that impressed me as I was learning about the church, even when I was still interviewing and then when I first came, was the fact that the church had a hiking group led by Binny and Chuck for many years. And once a month, they would plan, along with others, a hike in Marin. And what a joy it was and still is in the life of the church. I was able to go with them on just two hikes, Hamilton Wetlands and the Las Galinas Ponds. And I knew I was among very experienced birders, and I have a lot to learn. And I remember Binny whipping out one of her bird books and showing me exactly which birds we were looking at and what to look for and the variations among the species. So her enthusiasm was contagious. One moment in worship I will always remember was the celebration of Earth Day in 2019. The green team from our church had planned the service, and the sermon for that day was the story called Big Mama Makes the World by Phyllis Root. I actually have the book. Oh, I don't think you can see it. Oh, maybe so. That's the limitation of technology. It's a wonderful children's book, Big Mama Makes the World by Phyllis Root. And the whole congregation, children, adults ages 32 to probably 92, were totally captivated as Binny read this story in worship with the illustrations up on the screen. I think of all the books that she has read to her children and grandchildren, great-grandchildren and students through the years. A love of books is certainly part of her legacy. And music, I am grateful for Binny's love of music and her faithful presence in the chancel choir for decades. Early on, she gave me a list of the hymns that she thought the congregation knew well and sang well. That was a great gift for a new pastor to have. Clearly, she instilled a love of music in her children and grandchildren. Benny was incredibly caring. As a deacon in the church, this particular ministry focuses on offering care and support to the congregation. She was called to be ordained as a deacon because of her gifts of love and care. She was an excellent taker of minutes at the deacon's meeting, and those have been very useful as we have looked back on decisions and plans. And even when her term was over and she rotated off the board of deacons, she never stopped caring for people in the congregation and in her care group. I certainly appreciated Benny's humor and wit. She was so quick. I just appreciated conversations with her and her insights about life. She's generous and compassionate. I was so impressed to learn and read about the medical mission trips she and Chuck took to Guatemala through the years with Faith in Practice. I spent 5 weeks in Guatemala years ago and went to some of the villages that they would have visited and saw some of that incredible poverty and incredible need. And I'm so grateful for their work and the ongoing work of that organization. Penny was devoted. She was a devoted wife of Chuck and devoted mother of Will and Courtney and Lauren and Doug, and now their spouses and families. Their family have certainly had many amazing trips and adventures and family get-togethers. I'm so glad Benny was able to go to Colorado in those final months to be able to soak in family time there. We know that losing Chuck in December created a hole in her life and her spirit. I had hoped there were many years for Benny ahead to find a way forward without her beloved at her side. When the cancer diagnosis came, it certainly felt incredibly unfair and unbelievable. My one solace is that she passed away with her children and family gathered around her. She died peacefully. In some mysterious way, I trust that she is with Chuck and their love goes on. Benny inspired me. I miss her. So today we give thanks for her life, her love for her family and friends and church, and we give thanks that she is at peace. And now Kay Collette will share her reflections.
When Benny and Chuck arrived in San Rafael back in the 60s, they visited First Presbyterian on the recommendation of friends, and they never left. Their wisdom and steady-as-you-go presence brought a stability and strength to this congregation for many years. We all mourn their passing immensely and are so grateful for their many long years with us. Benny loved the choir and was proud to sing tenor with her buddy, Donna Butler. In and out of church, she lived as a deacon, helping and providing for any need without fail. She was quick-witted, reliable, determined, always running late, and infinitely kind. We owe our thanks to Benny's older sister, Polly, for her nickname, because when she was little, Polly couldn't say Lavinia, so it was Labini. Years later, Benny told Polly, "If it wasn't for you calling me Benny, I'd never be able to be a tomboy." My friendship with Benny was forged over 15 years of five of us church women of a certain age, unofficially meeting for 1 hour every morning. Initially, it was a way to visit with our 90-something-year-old friend, Esti Oliari. We started out by my leading Lectio Divina, a meditative reading of scripture that ends in an extended silence. It took me a while to realize that Esti fell asleep and the rest just politely waited for it to be over. Can you, especially Benny, can you imagine her enjoying silence for more than a nanosecond? Actually, Benny grew to love the slowed down nature of our gatherings, as well as our more serious readings of Thomas Keating and Richard Rohr and Mark Nepo and some Buddhist authors. We shared our joys and our fears together. I think we were all grateful for those moments when a sweet spirit united us in mind and heart. The last time I saw Benny was 2 weeks before she died. Her East Coast buttoned-up manner had eased, and we were able to talk a little bit about ultimate things. Benny was so deeply honest. She would never pretend any faith she wasn't dead sure of. But her curiosity, her trust was endless, and her heart was open. In a role reversal that day, she wanted to read to me from her cherished volume of Mary Oliver poems. As many of you know, Benny devoted herself to the Audubon Canyon Ranch as a director, a teacher, and especially a monitor of the heron rookery, where the heron babies were cared for. So I wanted to read a part of Mary Oliver's poem, "Heron Rises from the Dark Summer Pond," as our sacred text for today. Because I believe that the book of nature was Benny's favorite scripture. Heron rises from the dark summer pond. So heavy is the long-necked, long-bodied heron. Always it is a surprise when her smoke-colored wings open and she turns from the thick water, from the black sticks of the summer pond, and slowly rises into the air and is gone. Then, not for the first or the last time, I take the deep breath of happiness, and I think how unlikely it is that death is a hole in the ground. How improbable that ascension is not possible, though everything seems so inert, so nailed back into itself. But it isn't a miracle, but the common thing. This decision, this trailing of the long legs in the water, this opening up of the heavy body into a new life. See how the sudden gray-blue sheets of her wings strive toward the wind. See how the clasp of nothing takes her in. So just as the heron ascends from the thick black pond, so may we know that this opening of the body into a new life is not a miracle, but a common thing, mirrored for us as the great bird strives toward the wind and the grasp of nothing takes it in. The grasp of nothing we can see, but a mysterious something, a mysterious someone, who has taken our beloved Benny into the realm of pure love. Amen.
Hi, my name is Doug, and I'm Ben's youngest. I'm going to try to share a few slides while I talk here. My mom was a very active person. Sorry, I'm just trying to organize screens here a little bit so I can keep track of what I'm saying. So my siblings and I mentioned some of my mom's activities in her obituary. And I'd like to tell you a little bit more about her personality as I knew her. My mom had a very active mind, often racing from one thing to the next. There were so many things to do. My siblings and I joke that ideas would pop into her head like squirrels in the park. And like any of her beloved dogs over the years, her brain would immediately give chase to the new ideas. We'd laugh and say, squirrel! But man, did she keep track of and get a lot of things done. My mom was a counter. Partly, I think, it gave the squirrel hunting part of her brain a place to rest. And she used it with us, too. At 9, I remember her distracting me from the unpleasantly long climb up the Eiffel Tower by coaxing me to count the steps. And I remember that she wouldn't let me fly a paper airplane off it. In Santa Barbara, we live near the beach, and she maintained that there are 241 steps down to the water, which after 20 years, I've never been able to confirm. I always lose count on the landings. After decades of singing in the church choir, I bet that she could have told us the exact numbers. All of the light fixtures in the sanctuary, all the stained glass panels, all the organ pipes, the carved panels on the cross, and then every other countable thing in the sanctuary. Speaking of the choir, my mom was a musician. She would not have said that, but she loved music and she sang with us kids all the time. She pushed us to take music lessons and suffered mostly silently through interminable rounds of piano, trumpet, flute practice, only occasionally interrupting with a B flat. All four of us have fond memories when we were little of listening to her play Chopin's preludes on the piano when she would take a few moments for herself. And we'll play one of her favorites during the slides a little later. In January, she and I went to the Marin Symphony together. I always enjoy the symphony, but I was struck by how much more it meant to my mom. She positively glowed at the end of the performance, having been moved by each piece. And we talked about it all the way home. My mom was a keeper of traditions. There were big traditions around the major holidays, of course. And there are dozens and dozens of pictures of family and friends gathered around mom's table. And I apologize in advance for focusing our slides today mostly on family in the interest of time. Christmas was my mom's favorite holiday. She was delighted to discover that Pop's family used the same Christmas stocking pattern as her clan. And soon after marriage, she took over knitting the stockings for her family, then extended family, and then maybe one or two a year for beloved friends, their spouses, their children, especially children. Decorating the tree, putting out greens, candles, all the Christmas figurines, putting up the Advent calendar, reading the night before Christmas, singing carols, leaving out cookies for Santa. But there were traditions for all seasons, intricately constructed Valentines, May Day bouquets, flying the flag for veterans, and of course, cherry pie for Washington's birthday. Every summer found her up a ladder picking plums for her coveted jelly. 3 summers ago, a friend spotted her clambering up and insisted on stopping and holding the ladder for her. She laughed, but gratefully, scoffing at the idea that at a mere 81 years old, she might need to be more cautious. And then two summers ago, she thought that I was really being a little overprotective when I took over the picking. Especially so when one of my ladder legs sank into soft soil and I took the tumble that she'd always avoided. We had several good laughs over that. For house guests, she kept the freezer stocked with a sour cream coffee cake or two, homemade peach or plum ice cream, and always at least one tin of cookies. Day-to-day rituals were important too. For instance, the youngest present got to ring her grandparents' dinner chimes before meals. Now, there were a number of the youngest gets to traditions, including, oddly, pouring the wine, which apparently started at her mom's remarriage when my mom was 5. That's her in the lower left. As the youngest of my siblings, I was often the beneficiary of these traditions. They made me feel special. And my mom and I often shared a conspiratorial wink around maintaining little rituals when my teenage siblings had grown too cool for such things. As I grew towards adulthood, I confess feeling a little constrained by some of her daily traditions, seeing them as unnecessary rules where things had to be done just so. But I came to see that her focus on traditions and rituals, large and small, were really based on two things. First, they spoke to her desire to do the right thing. My mom was intent on doing the right thing. If there were a right thing to do, and it was even vaguely within her power to do so, she did it. Personal cost was not really a consideration. Even friends and relatives who spent little day-to-day time in her household have commented on the breadth and depth of her volunteer service to community and friends. And so some of her focus on tradition really satisfied her idea, her urge to do the right thing. But a second thing that her role as a tradition keeper provided was a way to make the ordinary into something special. We all enjoy ice cream, to be sure, right? But when it's homemade peach ice cream, based on Great Aunt Ruth's legendary recipe, well, that elevates it to a new level. We're eating not just cool sweetness, but generations of love. And so as I look at the home she made for us, filled with antiques and stories from my grandparents, great-grandparents, and some even from triple great-grandparents, I feel a deep anchor into generations of family love. My mom was an adventurer. It's funny because I grew up seeing her as just a typical mom, keeping house, raising kids, doing the suburban thing. I had credited most of the travel and adventure that my parents undertook, visiting the corners of the earth. I attributed most of that to my dad. I mean, I knew my mom had a few stories of adventures before marriage and kids. I was organizing a trip around Europe with college friends. Then a year later, talking her way into free passage on a freighter, going across the Atlantic again to Europe, figuring that once she got there, she would find a place to live and get a job and, you know, teach herself to speak Dutch. And she did all of that and raced around Amsterdam on her scooter for a year. And then when she came home, there was that 6,000 mile cross-country road trip in her convertible through sandstorms, improvising the whole itinerary and somehow making a surprising number of new friends along the way. But when I put the timing together recently, all of that was just in 3 years, it occurred to me to doubt that many of her classmates squeezed in half as much adventure in twice the time. Having kids changed the style of her adventures for a while, but I was only 7 when she bought a van for a cross-country road trip with her brother and the 3 youngest. And it's been interesting for me to reflect back over her life and see just how far outside the norm she was. She enjoyed her last sail with us just 6 weeks before passing away. My mom loved nature. She loved birding in particular. Something about birds seemed to calm the inner squirrel. And she would sit rooted for long periods, noting details of plumage and movement, waiting for hidden birds to flush, or adding to her thorough bird lists for each place that she visited. And she meticulously tracked the egrets on West Marin Island for many years. She loved tide pooling, and she volunteered for decades, bringing school groups out to Audubon Canyon Ranch, and loved to introduce them to the egrets and the pond critters. When we weren't out camping or hiking or boating, she read to us her beloved Thornton Burgess nature stories, Sammy Jay, Reddy Fox, and Peter Rabbit, stories which were read to her by her grandmother. My mom was a game player, always competitive in a game, but always gracious about winning, or rarely losing. When we were young and bored, even though I'm sure she had a laundry list of tasks to accomplish, taking care of the four of us, she would always offer up a game as though she had nothing that was more important in that moment. She taught us to be graceful losers by never letting us win, but congratulating us warmly when we occasionally did. And when standard games weren't working, she was always game to try something new. My mom was a devoted wife for 57 years. And among the most frequent comments that I have heard from friends of my parents since their passing has been on the remarkable and enviable strength of their partnership. That didn't just happen, of course. It was intentional. Mom laughed about how she and Pop recycled their Valentine's cards. She had a bag of them in her desk drawer, and each year would pick one that seemed right for the moment to give again to Pop. And then she would leave the bag out for him to pick one for her. They would exchange the cards that evening and smile again at their romance. Then Mom would keep the cards out on the table for a week or so and then pack them away for the next year. It was one of the many ways that she worked to nurture their relationship. And my mom was a nurturer, an educator, a child raiser. Of course, I see her as a mom because she was mine. But she was also a mom to so many others in so many ways. She was nurturing her cousins when still a child herself. She was a second mother to a number of my siblings' friends. She nurtured a love of nature and a love of reading in her family and hundreds of school children. And she loved feeding people, especially with her special family favorites. So, nurturing family, maintaining traditions, enjoying nature, doing the right thing, and then doing it again. That was my mom.
So,
I'm going to be really brief. I started to write and I realized I could write for a very long time about my mom. But it would be way too much. So Doug said he found writing about our mom much harder than about our dad. And as did I. She was more like jagged, different pieces of colored glass like a kaleidoscope. I should have said, yes, Doug, girls are harder. I don't think my dad was a simple man. He was intellectual and observant. And without my mom, I think he would have lived probably a very withdrawn and not by design, but just through lack of doing something different, I think he would have not have had a very social life. But my mom gave my dad a lot of bright lights and people coming through the house all the time. And among the many things he gave her, I'm sure my dad gave my mom a kind of solidity and groundedness that let her be more than she might otherwise have been. And so, of course, that's what a great partnership is about. She was always lively. Time for a quick walk? Sure, she'd say, wildly erratic in her understanding of time. She broke the space-time continuum for a number of things packed into a single day or week or year, batches of cookies in a lifetime, 68,000. If she'd thought of it, she would have counted. Recently, we went on the last of what I call our epic adventures. The last one was going to be Madagascar, which really was epic. We went to Alaska on a boat. It was great. And the whole time, of course, we all knew it was our last trip. With the six of us all together, plus the spouses, the children, etc. But my dad was sick, and so that was going to be the last one. So we may have other trips. I hope we have other trips, but they'll be different. Of course, every trip is different. Anyway, but not in that particular way. My parents had their anniversary on that trip, and that slide Doug showed with the 57th anniversary was us on a boat in Alaska. And so many people on that Alaska boat said one of their favorite things on the trip was seeing us, really a family of strangers, together, and to see how much we love each other. So many people commented on that, how visible that love was. They didn't know it was our last trip. Why should they? I think the other people of our family were doing the same thing I was, which is, why should they know? Why should they be burdened by this knowledge? These people on their nice vacation, right? And that's something, of course, I got from my mom to think about, what about these other people? And they don't need to be that, knowing that, to make them sad or feel awkward. And again, that was my mom always doing the right thing. And I miss her already so much. But she left a great legacy. She left a family that loves, we all love each other very much. And I'm very grateful. That's all.
Thanks. And thanks, Doug, for the extensive thorough picture, I think, of our mom. I'm Will. I'm the second born and the tallest of the children. And I'm going to start with a poem from the book of Mary Oliver's poems that she was reading in the last few months. This is Roses, Late Summer. What happens to the leaves after they turn red and golden and fall away? What happens to the singing birds when they can't sing any longer? What happens to their quick wings? Do you think there's any personal heaven for any of us? Do you think anyone, the other side of that darkness, will call to us, meaning us? Beyond the trees, the foxes keep teaching their children to live in the valley. So they never seem to vanish. They are always there in the blossom of the light that stands up every morning in the dark sky. And over one more set of hills along the sea, the last roses have opened their factories of sweetness and are giving it back to the world. If I had another life, I would want to spend it all on some unstinting happiness. I would be a fox or a tree full of waving branches. I wouldn't mind being a rose in a field full of roses. Fear has not yet occurred to them, nor ambition. Reason they have not yet thought of. Neither do they ask how long they must be roses, and then what? Or any other foolish question. Back in a sec. I wrote the first draft of this eulogy on a memo pad headed from Charles T. Fisher, MD. Biddy and Chuck, mom and dad, were partners for most of their long and happy lives. And their partnership was a source, and probably the source, of their happiness. No, I won't. I can't try to summarize my parents' marriage or my mother's life, our mother's life, especially in the virtual presence of so many who knew them and her so well. At this moment, many of you can probably recall a moment when Biddy surprised you with an insight, an act of kindness, a surprisingly candid comment. Many of you remember how hard she tried to do well, to do right, to live up to the demanding ideals of her New England family. You all know how important music was in Biddy's life. She loved the symphony, as Doug said, and the choir, as Cynthia mentioned, and especially Handel. One of my own regrets is my failure to achieve the last trumpet solo in Messiah for her. But I want to tell you about an old sweet song, a spiritual she learned as a girl at camp with Polly, that she taught to her kids, that we sang with her in the car on long drives to Lake Tahoe, drinking paper cups of potato leek soup from the thermos and not reaching the snow. That's what we call it. Have we got to the snow yet? getting there well after dark and long past bedtime. Now, Dad Dad didn't sing, but the rest of us did, and he listened. Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. When we were kids, the grammar seemed a little peculiar. And the notion was odd because home was our house, not some place we'd be carried off to. But the tune was sweet and we sang it joyously. Half a century later, my sister Courtney and I were sitting up late at Mom's bedside, very early in the morning of the day she died. We sang to her together that old song. We put our hearts into it. We put in the flourishes that are a little scary when you're not sure whether they're going to work. We sang as beautifully and as joyously as we could for her. And she heard us. I don't know what she believed there at the end. But I hope she believed that she was indeed going home, to the home of her heart, that she and Chuck would be together again. She smiled at us, squeezed my hand, and slipped out quietly a little later, passing, I do believe, in joyful hope. I hope all of us are so lucky. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Hugh Harris. I am Benny's and Polly's younger brother. And I'd like to tell you a little bit about Benny's early life, except I wasn't around for it. But what I can remember, what I know about, is a lot about her grandparents' house where Benny and Polly and our mom lived for a number of years during World War II. it was a great place to live and to visit for me. And it was out in the countryside in Connecticut with lots of trees and meadows and forests and a lake with a boat. Oh, it had a rowboat. Vinny started boating there, I think. Our grandmother was a very sweet, gentle woman with a real eye for nature and what was going on around her. And curiously, one of the bedrooms where my aunt had grown up when she was a child was now the main guest room. One time when I was in there, probably messing things up a little bit, my grandmother very gently said, you know, we want to be careful with this room. We want to keep it neat and nice looking, because if Queen Elizabeth ever came to visit, this is where she would stay. And I thought at the time that was an odd way to look at things. But that's how my grandmother looked at it, that having a good place for the queen to visit if she ever did. There was a wildflower garden out beyond the fence, where you had to take a stile to cross over the fence, and then down through the meadow and into the woods, and there was a brook and a spring. And it was fascinating to walk there with my grandmother, to have her point out the wildflowers and the trees and shrubs. And this is where a lot of Benny's important things about nature came from, I think. And singing, well, at family parties, when I would go there years later, but when she was growing up, I'm sure it was the same. Singing was important. After the turkey dinner was finished and people had rested a while and were playing games, and then they would go back to the kitchen and sing. Swing Low, Sweet Chariot was a popular song, and my aunt insisted that the harmony be good with it. So a lot of the thriftiness and self-reliance sense of that came from living there during World War II. Our grandparents had a big vegetable garden and fruit trees and a blueberry patch and raised chickens and a couple of cows. And they canned vegetables and made plum jam, probably. So that's where a lot of Benny's ideals came from, I think. Years later, after Benny had gone off to college and came back to visit to the house one weekend or something, a bunch of people somehow she had met that attended Princeton came to visit. Oh, they were members of the Princeton Tiger Tones, the Princeton men's choral group. And Benny and our mom were just delighted to have them there visiting and singing for an hour or so. And even I thought it was pretty cool. One of the things years ago when we were camping somewhere and looking at the sky at night, and it was at the time it was winter, the winter sky was visible, Orion, with the bright stars around Orion were visible. Benny wanted to know what the names of the stars were, so I told her there's Sirius, Procyon, Pollux, and Castor, Capella, and Aldebaran in a big arc going clockwise around Orion. And over the years since then, every few years, I don't know, 6 or 8 years later, we'll be out at night and see those stars, and she'll remember. Yes, it takes her a minute maybe to remember, but it's Sirius, Procyon, Pollux, and Castor, Capella, and Aldebaran. And I think it's sort of like the part of her brain that like to know what bird it was and remember it and write it down if she needed to, and keep track of which birds were which. She wanted to know which stars were which. And so you can see that part of the sky now. It's rising in, I don't know, midnight hours. And you can see it if you get up early in the morning tomorrow, 5 or 6 in the morning before you're starting to get light. You will see Orion and Sirius and Procyon and Pollux and Castor and Capella and Aldebaran. And I will always think of Benny when I see that part of the sky again. So thanks for everybody for joining us.
Hello, everyone. My name is John Kelly, and I'm so honored to share just a few words about Benny's amazing love of birds. I've known Benny for about 35 years, initially through my work as the Director of Conservation Science at Audubon Canyon Ranch. We spent a lot of time chasing birds together all over San Francisco Bay, all over Tomales Bay, and all around Bolinas Lagoon. And for almost 30 years, we worked together on a particular study of herons, negrets, and some other birds at the Marin Islands National Wildlife Refuge, which hosted up to a spectacular 900 nesting pairs of herons and negrets. Every year, Benny sent me tons of notes and tabulated numbers and sketches, which she recorded continually from her living room window. In that spot, she, with her binoculars and telescope, she had an excellent, almost perfect view of the islands. And then several times each season, we took our research boat together out to the islands. We worked closely as a team, using both of our telescopes to share an intimate close-up view of the birds and their activities in each nest. It's super fun. We could have been way more efficient at getting the data that we needed, but Benny always insisted that we stop and watch every single thing that happened in or near the colony. So whenever there was a bird returning from the nearby wetlands, she'd say something like, "Stop, incoming egret." And we'd have to stop and follow the bird and see where exactly where it lands and find out what it was up to. Or she'd say something like, "Wait, there's a feeding at nest number 34. And then we'd aim our telescopes at the nest and she'd marvel with all her concentration at the family feeding frenzy and the antics of the hungry nestlings. And I'd often hear her say very quietly, and I could still hear her voice, "Oh," or sometimes, "Oh, look at that." She'd seen these things a zillion times, but then she'd look over at me and lock eyes with that big Benny smile, or sometimes with a serious expression of awe, just to let me know that we'd seen something special. Benny responded like this to a lot of the things that we saw together over the years, and always with so much feeling, consistently for decades, was all about her love affair with birds. Our birding adventures gave us a lot of time to share stories about friends and our families and travels and other things. And her excitement about birds and nature seemed to fuel many of those stories. And I think it pretty much fueled her love of everything. And I'll always be thankful for that, because it was one of her wonderful gifts to all of us. Thanks.
Sorry for the problem with my screen. Good morning, I'm Jenny Pabst. I want to thank Benny's family for inviting me to participate. It is an honor. One thing Benny and I enjoyed together were the collective nouns given to aggregates of birds and animals. Phrases like a charm of goldfinches, a pod of porpoises, a school of whales, or a crown of kingfishers. Well, I learned a new one just about a week ago, a gratitude of birds. It's a perfect phrase, a gratitude of birds. And I wanted to tell Benny I knew she would love it, but I couldn't tell Binny. So instead, I'm telling all of you. And maybe if she hears, it'll make her smile. Al and I and Chucky and Binny have shared 25 years of friendship. We've done a lot of walking and talking and reading and discussing and just all kinds of activities. But certainly being out in nature, walking the four of us together, is just among the best of memories. It was wonderful to talk wildflowers with Binny. I'm not in the birding league. I couldn't keep up there. But I could talk wildflowers with Binny. And it was a joy to talk with her because she was so filled with joy. And I loved the way she would be engaged with the wildflowers. She just didn't say, passing by, oh, that's a Mariposa lily. You had to stop and you had to really look at it and study it. And where was it growing and why was it there? And what was near it? And what did it need? She gave it her full attention. The flower mattered. Binny enjoyed the flower. In retrospect, it is those qualities of being engaged and paying attention and caring that made being with Binny so special. She listened when you spoke to her. She heard what you said, not just the words, but what was underneath them. She gave this attention to things big and small. Several years ago, a niece from Maine came to visit. Steffi's an avid birder and naturalist, and I was going to take her to Audubon Canyon Ranch. But I thought Steph would have more fun if she had a better birder partner to go with her. So I asked Binny if she would come along and be our guide for the day. We had a wonderful time, every minute of it. And we went toward top to bottom and all around. And we talked about birds and plants and the rookery and rat's nests and all kinds of things. But what I remember best is standing on a small bridge down in the ponds, and I'm standing, and Binny and Steffi, two grown women, one in her 60s, one in her 40s, kneeling all four, on all fours, leaning forward to look under the bridge to see the newts. Now, I know newts are interesting. They really are interesting, but I never got excited about seeing a newt. But Steph and Binny were thrilled. There was such joy in seeing the newts. It's a wonderful way to be. I learned to love the newts. The biggest adventure we ever had was our trip to Antarctica. Al and I were going, and we asked Binny and Chuck if they wouldn't like to come along. Chuck was on board the minute he heard the word. Took Binny a little convincing, but as soon as she said yes, we all started to move forward with our plans. In the end, Al and I and Chuck and Binny and friends and relatives, family, made up a party of 10. And we were all excited from the very beginning of making plans. But when we stepped on that ship, knowing we were going to cross the Southern Ocean, it all turned awesome. And every moment of the trip was filled with awe. All of us were excited. All of us had, it was the most fun I ever had. I think everybody feels like that. It was exciting and educational and insightful and was a fabulous trip. But I think of all of us, it's possible that Binny had the very best time because she had this quality of paying such close attention always. I never met her any day on that trip when she didn't have something to share or show or tell or ask. She was really present. Binny just paid attention. And she paid attention to people the way she paid attention to nature. She listened. She learned. You mattered. She was a deacon to all, not just in the church, but in the community, on the mission trips, and in Guatemala, as we've heard. Binny was filled with light. It was that inner light that guided how she was in the world and how she saw the world. And she shared her light with the world. And I am fortunate to have been her friend. Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you.
What a woman, what a family, what a life. I want to share a short poem with you that I had read to the Monday morning group that Benny asked me to send to her. And I think it shows one of the reasons that Benny loved to watch the birds, to watch them ascend and float effortlessly on an updraft. And that she longed for that kind of freedom too, because she was always so busy doing everything. Just to lie back and trust that you don't have to be busy to be a good person. The avowal. As swimmers dare to lie, to face the sky and water bears them, as hawks rise and rest upon air and air sustains them, so would I learn to attain free fall and float into Creator Spirit's deep embrace, knowing no effort earns that all surrounding grace. Amen.
Let's pause for a moment of silence and then a brief prayer. Holy One, source of all love, we thank you for the great company of all those who have finished their race and who now rest from their labor. We are grateful for those dear to us who have died and rest in your eternal love. Today we especially thank you for Benny Fisher. We are grateful for her life, her joy, her caring for others, her love of birds and nature, her openness, her love of life. May we learn from her what it means to live fully and love deeply. In a spirit of love, we remember the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples in the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we conclude our service today, I would like to pause so that we can take a moment to see everyone who's attending. Ordinarily, we would move now from the sanctuary where we have celebrated Benny's life and walk down the hall to Canoles Hall at our church and have a reception and have an opportunity to talk with each other and catch up with each other. But since that's not possible, I invite you to take a moment and change your view on Zoom to what's called gallery. And you should see all the little boxes pop up. And depending on your device, you might need to swipe with your hand or look on the right-hand side of the screen with your mouse for an arrow. I can see on mine that there are 5 pages. We have over 100 people, 112 people have Zoomed in. So I invite you to take a few moments now and look and see people's faces and names as you move through the pictures. There is not a way to talk on Zoom in this situation. You have to stay muted, but you can, please stay muted, but you can type in the chat. So in Zoom language, if you want to chat, you need to type, go down to the bottom in most of them, and type a message to an individual. If you see someone's face or name that you haven't been in touch with, you can send a message directly to them or to everyone. So I wish we could all be together in the room and talk with each other, but that is not possible. So this meeting will stay open for another 30 minutes. Please make sure you're muted so that we can conclude the service. But you can keep, there's not a way to have an individual conversation by talking, but you can type and chat. So following the benediction blessing, I invite you to keep looking at names and faces and send your love and blessing to everyone who's here. So let me offer a blessing, and I'm going to make sure that everybody is muted.
Is that true?
And Mike, if you'll put my picture back up. So in gratitude for Benny, and as we move out into this day, may you go into this day with a blessing of comfort. May you feel a wonderful urgency to live your life fully. May you live compassionately and creatively. May you go in peace that comes from divine mystery and the source of all love. And may you always know you are rooted and grounded in love. Amen. The
trumpeter's sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, be raised incorruptible. We shall be changed.